would you stand with us?
Joy to the world, the Lord has come. Let earth receive her King. Let every heart prepare Him room, and heaven and nature sing, and heaven and nature sing.
Jesus, Emmanuel. adore him.
Amen. Yeah. That's what we've come to do this morning. So let's keep on singing. Good morning, everyone. It's good to see you all here, and it's good to see you all here online as well. We welcome you, those here in the room, those watching online, those who've been a part of Living Grace for a long time, those who might be a little bit newer, we welcome you. We're so glad that you have joined us as we celebrate this fourth Sunday of Advent, And as always, we would just want to encourage you to connect with us through our connection card. There are connection cards at the backs of the seats, and you can fill that out and put it in the basket on your way out. There are digital connection cards online. We'd love for you to communicate that way with us, especially if you're watching online. It's a way for you to send us prayer requests, let us know things that are happening in your life. It's a way for you to get to know Living Grace a little bit more, and a way for us to get to know you as well. So just want to encourage you to do that. Today's the day, if you haven't already brought in your gifts, if you took a tag from our Christmas tree in the coffee room today, if you haven't brought your gift back, then maybe there's still time earlier in the coming week, but we're actually turning in those gifts. We turned in half of the gifts last week to City Life. They were so grateful for those gifts, and then we're going to turn in some more to another a local school in the area, and they're going to provide these gifts for a family in need. And I want to thank all of you for participating in that. You have been so generous. You have communicated the love of Jesus through your generosity, and so I really, really appreciate that, and I'm sure they do as well. I know they do, and there will be other opportunities here in the coming weeks and months to continue to give and to serve and to love on our community, so appreciate you doing that. We're going to continue in singing together, and I just want to just start with a word of prayer. God, we are so grateful just for this opportunity to be together again. It happens every week. It happens every Sunday morning, but it's so significant. Just the opportunity that we have to gather as your people, to worship you through singing, through opening your word to see what you have to say to us. Just the incredible opportunity that we have, and even the opportunity to worship you as we hang out with one another and chat with one another, spend time with one another. And all these things, we want to bring you glory. We want to point the way to you. You're the reason that we are here. And so I pray that we'll continue to do that as we continue to sing and lift up the name of Jesus. Amen.
Jesus, born to set thy people free from our fears and sins, release us, let us find our rest in thee. Israel's strength in consolation,
to earth until the sky is
I'm going to invite the Beaten Box to come up now. Brian and Amy and Jesse and Asher, the daughter. Haley's homesick, but maybe she's watching online. Hi, Haley. But they're gonna light our candles and read the scripture today.
Good morning. A few weeks ago, we started lighting the candles around the Advent wreath, and the first one that we lit was the candle of hope. Then in week two, we lit the candle of peace. And last week, we lit the candle of love. And this morning, the fourth candle, the fourth week of Advent, is all about joy. What a joy to light new candles, right? We have a few passages of scripture to read. This one first comes from Isaiah 52, 7 to 10. It says, "How beautiful on the mountains are the feet of those who bring good news, who proclaim peace, who bring good tidings, who proclaim salvation, who say to Zion, 'Your God reigns.' Listen, your watchmen lift up their voices. Together they shout for joy. When the Lord returns to Zion, they will see it with their own eyes. Burst into songs of joy together, you ruins of Jerusalem, for the Lord has comforted his people. He has redeemed Jerusalem. The Lord will lay bare his holy arm in the sight of all the nations, and all the ends of the earth will see the salvation of our God."
Luke 2, 8 through 11. "And there were shepherds living out in the field nearby, keeping watch over their flocks by night. An angel of the Lord appeared to them, and the glory of the Lord shone around them, and they were terrified. But the angel said to them, 'Do not be afraid. I bring you good news that will cause great joy for all the people. Today, in the town of David, a Savior has been born to you. He is the Messiah, the Lord.'"
John 1:14. "The Word became flesh and made his dwelling among us. We have seen his glory, the glory of the one and only Son, who came from the Father, full of grace and truth."
Revelation 21, 1 through 4. "Then I saw a new heaven and a new earth, for the first heaven and the first earth had passed away, and there was no longer any sea. I saw the whole holy city of the New Jerusalem coming down out of heaven from God, prepared as a bride beautifully dressed for her husband. And I heard a loud voice from the throne saying, 'Look, God's dwelling place is now among the people, and he will dwell with them. They will be his people, and God himself will be with them and be their God. He will wipe every tear from their eyes. There will be no more death or mourning or crying or pain, for the old order of things has passed away."
And finally, from Philippians 4:4, "Rejoice in the Lord always. I will say it again, rejoice."
Thanks. So what is the Christmas season like for you? For some, it often looks something like this. I like that. I mean, it's the most wonderful time of the year, right? Season of joy. But for many, maybe they're just trying to conjure up these happy feelings that the Christmas season is supposed to bring, right? But maybe for some, they just feel like their life is a mess. Maybe you're just trying to survive for the holidays. Maybe it's just such a stressful time for you, trying to get to everything done, trying to get everything accomplished. There's just so much to accomplish, right? Gifts to buy, gifts to wrap, and schedules to figure out, food to prepare, trying to just get everything done. Sometimes it's hard to find joy in that. Maybe for you, it's a lost loved one. Maybe this season is just going to be really different for you because you've lost a loved one, and it's going to be really, really difficult for you to find joy in that. Maybe Maybe you have strained family relationships, and so getting together for the holidays is just an extra stressful time for you. Maybe it's hard to find joy in that. I mean, this is supposed to be the season of joy, right? And when the season is over, you know, what then? Maybe for you, it just doesn't get any better. So maybe the question to ask is, what is life like for you? Is it joyful? Do you have joy? Are you experiencing joy? That's what we're going to talk about today. We're going to talk about joy and how we can experience joy. Where does joy come from? Where does true joy, lasting joy, come from? And so as we've done each week through this series, we're going to first of all look back in remembrance. So the fourth Sunday of Advent, you know, we're lighting the candle of joy, and it's often called, maybe you know this, it's often called the shepherd's candle. And some have asked, well, why is it pink? And you know, I don't necessarily know the full answer to that. Maybe if you've kind of grown up in a liturgical tradition, you may have a better answer. But pink is supposed to be a liturgical color that represents rejoicing and celebration. So it's the shepherd's candle. And that's where I want to start today, and we're going to start in the very familiar passage from Luke chapter 2, the famous passage, the most famous part of the Christmas story that most of us know, and we're very familiar with this, but I just want us to put ourselves in the shoes of the shepherds that night. And as we read this passage from Luke chapter 2, we're going to be reminded of the difference, the stark difference between religion and following Jesus. That's what we're going to take a look at today. We're going to discover where true joy comes from. Luke chapter 2, we're just going to read three verses, starting with verse 8. And there were shepherds living out in the fields nearby, keeping watch over their flocks at night. An angel of the Lord appeared to them, and the glory of the Lord shone around them, and they were terrified. But the angel said to them, "Do not be afraid. Do not be afraid." Your translation may say, "Fear not." Fear not. I mean, think about their situation here. They're out in the field at night, they're watching their sheep. The glory of the Lord is shining all around them. The glory of the Lord. We can't even really fathom that or imagine that. An angel of the Lord appears to them out of nowhere. And this isn't the, you know, the white fluffy angel with the wings and the halo. No, this is probably a mighty warrior appearing to them. The glory of the Lord shining. God says through the angel, this message to them is, fear not. Fear not. Now, let's think about this for a little bit. In their context, they would have been very familiar with kind of the gods of that day, the Greek gods, the Roman gods, and they would have probably recalled their history, you know, in slavery in Egypt and exiled to Babylon, and so they were very familiar with the gods of the Egyptians and the Babylonians and the Greeks and the Romans. And so they knew that all of those gods were to be feared. To be feared. Don't mess with those gods. Don't tick those gods off. The gods were fickle. They never knew how the gods would respond or react to them. Make sure to get on the good side of these gods. You have to appease the gods. This is kind of what they believed back in that day about the gods. They were to be feared. And that kind of sounds strange to us, doesn't it? But we believe the same sort of things today. That's what religion is. That's exactly what religion's all about, all religions. And sadly, it's how many people think they need to relate to God. Because fear is humanity's default way of responding to God. It's just kind of our natural way of relating to God. We relate out of fear. Because most people recognize that we live in this messed up world. We just kind of look around and we realize this world is really messed up. And some people too, they often realize that something's just kind of messed up with them. They realize there's junk in my life. They might not call it sin, but they kind of might recognize that something just isn't quite right. And many probably even recognize or deep down inside they know that there's got to be some kind of God out there, some kind of higher power out there. And if that's the case, then with my junk in my life and, some God out there, whatever he's like, I don't quite measure up. And so just like Adam and Eve in the garden running and hiding, they're continually running and hiding from God, responding in fear, just staying one step ahead of the lightning bolt that they think is coming for them, right? Staying as far away from God as possible. They're always on the run. Now, on the other hand, you have very religious people who recognize sort of the same things, that there's a messed up world, there's a messed up self. And so what do? They try to take control of the situation through their effort, trying to figure God out, doing what they think will appease God, getting on God's good side. Does this start to sound familiar? Living a good life, doing good things, hoping their good outweighs their bad. And these religious people they're often legalistic, they're often judgmental because they want to deflect the attention off of themselves and, onto others, point out the bad in others so that no one sees the bad in themselves. But they want to draw attention to the good that's in themselves, right? You're following all the right rules. But this is all about fear as well. It's based on fear. That's what religion is. Religion is all about fear. It's based in fear. But the God of the universe, the one true God, the creator of all things, the God who pursues us, pursues relationship, which we talk about all the time, he's out. He comes to the shepherds through these angels out in the field that night. I mean, just think about it. His glory is on display for these shepherds, and his son is lying in a manger nearby. He says, I've come to you, and you do not have to be afraid. Fear not. Don't be afraid. I bring you good news that will cause great joy. Good news. We say that a lot. We've heard of the good news. It's from the Greek word euangelion. It means good announcement or good news, which we say, and which it says here. And it's often translated what? We know the word gospel. Gospel. And I think sometimes this word just gets too familiar to us. We talk about the gospel, and we talk about the good news, but what was this good news? What was this big announcement? We have to go back nearly 600 years before this moment right here with the shepherds. Jerusalem lay in ruins, destroyed by the Babylonians. Most of the Israelite people were sent into exile. There was a remnant that remained in the land amongst the ruins. And this was just devastating for them. So devastating. I mean, this was the place where God was supposed to rule. The place, Jerusalem, where God was supposed to reign. Things were not good for them. But we read in the book of Isaiah, chapter 52, this beautiful poem. And I want to read, how beautiful on the mountains are the feet of those who bring good news, who proclaim peace, who bring good tidings, who proclaim salvation, who say to Zion, your God reigns. Listen, your watchmen lift up their voices. Together they shout for joy. When the Lord returns to Zion, they will see it with their own eyes, burst into songs of joy together, you ruins of Jerusalem. For the Lord has comforted his people. He has redeemed Jerusalem. The Lord will lay bare his holy arm in the sight of all the nations, and all the ends of the earth will see the salvation of our God. The good news was that one day a king would return, establish his kingdom, and set all things right. This is the gospel. This is the good news that the angels are proclaiming. Do not be afraid, I bring you good news. This is the huge announcement. It's not just an announcement, it's the announcement. What they had been waiting for so long. The king had finally arrived to restore his rule, to make all things new, to set everything right. So this was a cause for celebration. And we've talked a lot about how this kingdom was very strange. It was very different from what they expected. Born as a baby to a poor family. And then when he grew up, he began, you know, teaching and proclaiming these very strange things. He began proclaiming the good news. Good news for the poor, good news for the oppressed. He began healing and forgiving sins. This was just very strange. This is not what a king would do. Teaching strange things like love your enemies. And we've talked about how this was just an upside down kingdom. And this type of kingdom was so different. This type of kingdom, it requires surrender. It requires surrender. It requires laying down your life, laying down control, giving King Jesus control. That's what this kingdom is like. You see, religion is all about striving and working and effort, and it's exhausting. Religion is a burden. Religion is hard work. You never know if you've done enough. And even with the Old Testament sacrificial system they were very familiar with, you know, that couldn't even take care of the burden of sin. We read in Hebrews, day after day, every priest stands and performs his religious duties again and again. He offers the same sacrifices, which can never take away sin. But the good news of the gospel that should bring great joy is you can lay down that burden. You can surrender to Jesus. You can follow him. The good news is that the king has come to make things new, even in you and me. But it's his work. It's not yours. Jesus said, come to me, all you who are weary and burdened, and I will give you rest. Take my yoke upon you and learn from me, for I am gentle and humble in heart, and you will find rest for your souls. That's good news. It brings great joy. Do not be afraid. I bring you good news that will cause great joy for all the people. Wait a second. For all the people? For everyone? For every person? Even for the Gentiles? Yes. Even for the Samaritans? Yes. What about the Romans, our enemies? Yes. And even for you, shepherds. And we've talked about this before, but, you know, shepherds couldn't do anything for God. They couldn't even go to the temple and offer sacrifices because they were ceremonially unclean. They were outcasts. They were misfits. And Luke continues on in this chapter. We read, Luke tells us that when they heard of this good news, what did they do? They ran to find Jesus. They heard this good news. They ran to find the baby Jesus in the manger. And then after that, what did they do? They hurried. They hurried to spread the good news. How beautiful. How beautiful the feet that bring good news. Even the dirty, sinful feet of shepherds. And when Jesus grew up, began his ministry, he would emphasize this over and over again in his teaching and in his actions, hanging out with the sinners, hanging out with tax collectors, the misfits, the outcasts, and of course, the Pharisees, the religious people, they're mad. They're so upset about it. But Jesus answered them, it's not the healthy who need a doctor, but the sick. I have not come to call the righteous, but sinners to repentance. You see, religion is for those who think they're good enough. They think they can measure up. But this incredible announcement, this good news, was made to these lowly, dirty shepherds to make it very clear that this kingdom is made up of sinful people. People who recognize their sin and turn to King Jesus. Do you see the contrast here? It's just a huge contrast. Following Jesus is so different. It's so different from religion. Religion says you've got a heavy burden to lift. You've got a lot of work to do. But Jesus says, if you follow me, I'll offer you rest. I've already carried it. I've taken the heavy lifting all the way to the cross. I've done the work for you. That's why I came. Religion says, shape up and you just might be accepted. Jesus says, if you follow me, I'll shape you into the person I created you to be. Religion says that you can measure up. Maybe you can measure up with a lot of work and with a lot of effort, but Jesus says, follow me by recognizing that you can't. You can't measure up. You're a sinner in need of a Savior, and you must repent. And that word repent just has so many weird connotations to us nowadays, but it means turn from your way of life. Turn from doing things your way. That's sin. And turn to me. Turn to me. Following Jesus is so different from religion. Following Jesus is so different because it's about relationship. It's about relationship. We have to wrap our minds around that. Relationship. The story of Christmas shows us that. The Christmas story is all about relationship. Emmanuel, God with us. God came to be with us. We hear that all the time. But can we really wrap our minds around that? He came to be with us. He wants to be with us. And this theme, God with us, is a predominant theme throughout the scriptures. It starts in the beginning with Adam and Eve walking and talking with their creator in the garden in relationship with their creator, which was the way it was intended to be. And then they began trusting in themselves instead of him, and that relationship was severed. But God continued to pursue relationship with his people. So he made a way for people to experience his presence, experience a relationship with him in spite of their sin with the tabernacle in the wilderness. And we read in Exodus, he said, then have them make a sanctuary, a tabernacle for me, and I will dwell among them. I will dwell among them because I want to be with them. And later in Jerusalem with the temple, And throughout the scriptures, if you want to do this, if you have, you know, Bible Gateway or another kind of Bible app, just search, I will be with you. I mean, it's throughout the scriptures. I will be with you. I will be with you. I will be with you. God wants to be with us. And if there was still any question or doubt, there shouldn't be with the coming of Jesus. We read this verse all the time in John chapter 1. The Word, Jesus the Word, became flesh and made his dwelling among us. It literally says he tabernacled among us. Why? Because he's Emmanuel, God with us. Because he's a God who wants to be with us, desires a relationship with his people. And he's gone to great lengths to make that a reality. That's Christmas. It's not a religious celebration, but a celebration of relationship. A celebration of God with us. That is good news. That's good news, and it should cause great joy. Great joy. And so we look back and we remember that. We also look forward with anticipation to a time when our joy will be made complete. Isaiah chapter 25, starting with verse 6, says, on this mountain the Lord Almighty will prepare. On this mountain, they're talking about Jerusalem. The Lord Almighty will prepare a feast of rich foods for all peoples, a banquet of aged wine, the best of meats and the finest of wines. On this mountain, he will destroy the shroud that enfolds all peoples, the sheet that covers all nations. What's the shroud that we're covered in? Well, it says it in the very next line. He will swallow up death. Death forever. The sovereign Lord will wipe away the tears from all faces. He will remove his people's disgrace from all the earth. The Lord has spoken. And in Isaiah chapter 51, it says, those the Lord has rescued will return. They will enter Zion with singing. Everlasting joy will crown their heads. Gladness and joy will overtake them, and sorrow and sighing will flee away. And then Revelation chapter 21, which we read earlier. Then I saw a new heaven and a new earth, for the first heaven and the first earth had passed away, and there was no longer any sea. I saw the holy city, the new Jerusalem, coming down out of heaven from God, prepared as a beautiful bride, dressed for her husband. And I heard a loud voice from the throne saying, look, God's dwelling place is now among the people, and he will dwell with them. They will be his people, and God himself will be with them and be their God. He will wipe every tear from their eyes. There will be no more death or mourning or crying or pain, for the old order of things has passed away. See, someday, for those of us who have put our trust in that King, in King Jesus, we're going to see him face to face. And he will be with us, and we will be with him forever, which is what he has wanted. It's what he has wanted from the very beginning, a relationship with his people. It's hard to really fathom that he would want to be with me. But in the meantime, what does all that mean for the here and the now? How can we truly experience joy? Well, when you read about joy in the scriptures, the biblical meaning of joy is not based on circumstances. It has nothing to do with what's going on around you. When things are worth celebrating, when things are good, no, it has nothing to do with circumstances. Joy is not based on circumstances. But on the presence of God. Joy is based on the presence of God. Joy only comes through walking in relationship with your Creator. That's why you were created, to be with him. To be with him, and that's where your joy comes from. So, if you've experienced in your life the birth of a child, it's just joy. It's joyful, isn't it? So much joy. Why? Because God is there. God is with you. But if you're experiencing loss, in the midst of despair, you can still experience joy. Why? Because God is there. God is with you. If you're hanging out with family this Christmas season, that's joyful. That's joyful because God is with you. If you're just being, if you're stressed out and you're having a hard time getting everything accomplished, guess what? You can still experience joy because God is with you, no matter what you're going through. Because joy is not based on your circumstances. It's based on the presence of God. And if you have put your trust in Jesus, He is with you. God is with you. It's why Paul could say, rejoice in the Lord always. I will say it again, rejoice always, in all circumstances, when things are going well, when things are not. It's why Paul and Silas could sing songs of joy when they are in a prison cell and they had just been beaten within an inch of their life. They could sing songs of joy because God was with them. You know, at Christmas, it's really hard to talk about the manger without talking about the cross. I think it's impossible to talk about the manger without also talking about the cross, because we can't celebrate the birth of Jesus without remembering why he came to begin with, to die. The author of Hebrews says that for the joy set before him, Jesus endured the cross. For the joy set before him, he endured the cross. He endured the worst possible circumstances when he died on the cross. And it's a reminder that things are still messed up in our world. Things are not quite right. But with the coming of Jesus, Emmanuel, God with us, he has begun this restoration process. New creation has begun. And by surrendering to him, putting your trust in him, you can be forgiven of your sins. You can be made right with your Creator. You can experience a relationship with him, which is the way it was meant to be. And that's a decision with eternal significance, and a decision that you can make today. And if not today, I encourage you to continue to talk about it. And I'd even love to talk to you about it. The message of the manger and the message of the cross is not, it's not that we just have to endure this difficult life. We don't just have to endure this difficult life and all these negative circumstances and just hang on, because someday you're going to experience heaven. Just hang on. No, that's not the message of Christmas. That's not the message of the cross. Yes, we do get that someday, and we look forward to that. But the story of Christmas, the story of the cross, the story of the empty tomb, all that wrapped into one, is that we get to experience relationship. Relationship. Here and now. Relationship is the end goal. Relationship is the end goal. The gospel, the good news, is that we get God himself. We get God himself. We get to have a relationship with our Creator. And if we could really, truly wrap our minds around that we can experience a relationship with our Creator, what we were created for, That's the only true way that we can experience joy. That's good news. Good news of great joy. The worship team's going to come up now, and I just want us to spend some time thinking about that, contemplating the fact that God is with us. He wants to be with us. We have an opportunity for a relationship with Him each and every day, no matter what the circumstances, at all times. And as you sing this song and as you sit and pray and contemplate, just try to wrap your minds around that, that the God of the universe wants to be with you.
Yeah.
4 with me. Rejoice in the Lord always. I will say it again, rejoice. Stand and let's sing one last song together.
Yeah. Jesus Emmanuel, oh come let us adore him.
Thank you for being here this morning. We have a Christmas Eve service coming up, 6 p.m., and Christmas Eve is in person only. There will not be an online Christmas Eve service. In person only, Christmas Eve, 6 p.m. And then 2 days later on Sunday, we're going to do the opposite. It's going to be all online, no in-person service on December 26th. So Christmas Eve, 6 p.m. here, Sunday the 26th, all online. We hope you guys have a great Christmas. Maybe we'll see you back on Christmas Eve. Have an awesome week.
Long.